Call to order the regular meeting of the Chicago Board of Election Commissioners for Tuesday, January 6, 2014. Good morning. My name is Langdon Neal. I'm Chairman of the Board. Seat to my left is Commissioner Marisol Hernandez. To my right is Commissioner Richard Cowan. First item on the agenda is the consideration of the agenda itself. Any additions? If not, we'll move to item three, which is approval of minutes, and we don't have minutes for the last meeting. So we'll move to the Executive Director's report. Mr. Gough.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. As you can see, the office has been busy with electoral board hearings. I've been meeting with several aldermen and other elected officials, and they're questioning on the infrastructure project that we've done. And I've given an explanation of where we're at, but I have not really given a full explanation to the board members, and I'd like to do so at this meeting, if it's all right.
Please proceed.
The first item under the infrastructure project for 2013-2015 is the upgrade of the website. Mr. Allen, would you mind commenting? Because Jim Allen's heading that, and he's done an excellent job so far.
Thank you. Commissioners, if you go to the first page, section one, page one of three, we have a list of all of the projects for the three-year period, 2013-2015. The first one was the upgrade of the website there, and under there you see four areas: changing the hosting to a cloud facility that is both secure and expandable. That is complete. The second one, upgrading the software for content management, that is underway. And we are hopeful that we can launch the revised website on the updated software, newer software, later this month. If it goes much beyond that, we're going to stand pat through the primary and then finish it immediately after the primary. But we're hopeful that we can do it for this election for various reasons, not the least of which is to be able to provide a sample ballot in a new format that's not reliant on PDFs. So then the other two items essentially have already been taken care of, eliminating problems encountered with peak traffic loads on election day. We're already there with the expandable cloud environment. So really B is the big item that's left. Mr. Gough?
Okay, thank you. The other item is replacing optical scan ballot counters. We've tied up a lot of our time with the electronic poll books, which is going very well, but I don't want this to leave our radar screen. It's something that I've always said that we need to have replaced. I've asked Dominion to give us another proposal. I'm going to have some, in the next week or two, some things written up on this that I'd like to present to the board members, okay? So I just don't want this to leave our radar screen.
Is the issue here the funds? Is that the...
You know, that may be a non-issue. That's why I want to review this. So I just wanted the board members to be aware of that. Voter registration, polling place database, our election management system. There's a write-up that I've had Al Chase put together. It's going very well so far. Number four is the upgrade to the Edge2Plus and HAAT. Dominion's already done that. It's been completed. We're up ready for this primary election. The upgrade of the office workstation. Hopefully by the middle of February, all new computers will be installed and placed in all the departments. So I'm really happy that that's going as smoothly as possible to this point. Acquire additional floor space. This is something that I've been working with the building here and also with the county. 2015, with the number of hearings that we've had, we just don't have the space. What we look like we may acquire is the lunchroom on the 20th floor of this building.
We may be ours for approximately 2 months. So I'm working with Anna Ashcroft and her staff to come up with space because we are busting at the seams. You saw we use this office. We had to move stuff into the chairman's office. We're just running out of space. And with the number of objections to nominated petitions that we had 4 years ago, I think we're going to get the same amount for 2015, and it's going to be all over this building. So we're working really hard with the county and the city on finding additional space. And it's going, I would say, smoothly. They're listening to us. So hopefully we'll be able to do that. Also talking about the space, we did receive a call from the Harold Washington College that they would not have us use that area as training. I'm meeting with their management team. They're not in today, but we're going to have a meeting with them within the next week to see what we can do to try to work this out. As you know, Harold Washington was very vital on us doing our training. And to lose that, I just don't know where we're going to be able to go. So, and it's not like we've asked for the space to be for free. I think we paid $30,000 last time we used the space. So it's something that we're working on.
What is the reason that they're changing their position?
There's an increase in tuition. I mean, not tuition, in
enrollment.
And they said that they just don't have the space. We found out that there is an area in their theater, but they're saying they're getting ready to do a play after the primary election. They're building a stage, so it's something that we're going to have to try to work around. So we're still negotiating with Harold Washington College. So I wanted you to be aware of that. Upgrade of the email system, we've already completed that. As you know, we tried to come up with the standard email address, so that's been worked. Number 8, warehouse relocation. As you know, we're running out of space at our warehouse. With all the different projects that we have going on, especially with the poll books that's taking up additional space, met with General Services. They're looking at our space requirement. It looks like, and what at one time they were going to sell the middle building. They're not going to sell that, so it looks like we may be able to use some of that space. So I'm still working with General Services on that, and it's going really smoothly. They seem to be listening to our needs. And the last item is implementation of electronic poll books. Kelly and her staff has really been on top of that. I saw Audra here yesterday, and she was working on doing the manual, and Ms. Bateman had another meeting today. Kelly, you want to comment how that's going?
Yes, Audra is working insanely to get the not only the Judge of Election handbook ready to go to the printer this week so that it's available at training, but also just the e-poll book itself, the workflow that goes within inside the e-poll book. She's working very hard. We met today about carts, storage and charging carts for the e-poll books at the warehouse, as well as the cases that the e-poll books will be transported in and housed in. So it's going along. We will implement the e-poll book for the March primary, and everything's moving along fantastically.
Kelly, can we make this, Mr. Gough, can we make this a standing kind of report every board meeting?
Yes.
And
I think it's something we
can do. Yeah, I just want to, because I know you're taking on a lot, and it's hard for citywide implementation. So I just think if we could just get a weekly briefing, if that's okay with the commission, on how that's going. I also think that we should have somebody from ES&S here
will be at all our meetings
to either support or I may have to ask them some questions, but from now until March, I think somebody from ES&S should be here to just substantiate, you know, their work too.
Yeah. And I did meet with Judge today on a conference call, so he is within. And honestly, we were supposed to meet after the board meeting, but I texted him yesterday and said, weather-wise, whatever. But no, absolutely, yeah. He plans on being here for every meeting from this point forward. But I did meet with him this morning regarding some issues with the e-poll book. And we have a standard meeting, conference call meeting with the SNS. It starts Wednesday, so it'll be every Wednesday. Our staff will meet with the SNS. Some of them will be here in person, some will be here via conference call. But absolutely, we have a standard conference call set up every single Wednesday. And there was a representative from ESNS here last week, came in Thursday, was here till Saturday, worked with Audra. They are here at our disposal if we need them. So absolutely, they are working with us. You know, they fully understand the responsibility they have, and they are working with us to get this project implemented.
Great.
Absolutely.
Kelly, can you tell us a little bit about the training process for this? In other words, is this all on us? Is ESNS going to provide training support? And how are you going to modify your training? I know you got to work on the training manual first, but then when you get to training of judges, how are you incorporating it in your training program and blah blah blah?
Well, and again, I want to make it clear that this is now Audra's, and she's the manager of community services. I absolutely will be there to help her, but she's really taken on this role. The idea is ESNS will do a train-the-trainer program for us, probably at our warehouse, where every one of our election judge trainers, as well as our PPA trainers, will come, probably about a week's worth of training. And you know, this is what we did when we implemented the new equipment in 2006. You know, there will be days where we have four different locations of training going on. I think there's about 300 training classes that are scheduled. So it will be our staff actually training the election judges. Okay. And that's a role we have no problem with.
And how do you train the PPAs that we're going to be utilizing for this election?
How do we train them for the
on the poll book?
E-poll
when
books?
Do they fit into the process? Or how do they fit into the
It's a separate training.
A separate training.
Oh, absolutely.
Okay.
So the 300 is collectively election judges, student judges, PPAs,
okay.
Standby judges, standby PPAs. Yeah, the PPAs will have a separate training for both equipment as well as the new electronic poll books. The election judges, because this is the last election in this confirmation period, they're not required to go to a full credit, mandatory full credit training class like they will be in November.
Mm-hmm.
So we have the luxury of having a 2 or 2.5 hour class for all the judges that are returning who've already attended a training class. And of course, we'll refresh, you know, give them a refresher on the equipment and the processes, but we can really, really concentrate on the e-poll books at these classes. And we have about 9,000 returning judges who were trained either in 2012.
Okay.
So this is why it's a good idea to implement this during a primary election. And you know, like I said, 9,000 of our judges have returned their yes/no card saying they are available and ready to work.
Okay.
So
great, excellent. Anybody can jump in here. I have a couple more questions. Other than Harold Washington, are we okay on training space and? Okay.
We do 9 locations out in the field, out in the wards, where we'll take one location, for example, Polonia Banquets on the southwest side, and about 3 to 4 wards of judges will come to that training location and be trained. Our student judge training and our PPA training, we have secured locations for those two downtown. But here in Washington, it's so convenient.
Yes.
It has always just worked out so well for us, not only for election judge training, which goes for about 3 weeks, but also election day, as that's what we consider our standby central. So that houses our standby election judges, our standby PPAs, our investigators. That works out real well for us. So I'm hoping that we can get that changed.
Okay. Have we nailed down all the early voting sites?
Yes, we have.
So yes. That's not an issue.
Great,
fantastic. Last thing, a question I had, Mr. Gough, could you go over again that item 4, upgrades to the Edge2Plus and HAAT units?
Well, I can have Paige do that because she was overseeing the upgrade.
Okay, Paige.
Hi. Good afternoon.
So could you get give a little detail on this thing, the Edge2Plus, they've all been... The software has been updated.
Yes, it's the firmware for both the card activator and the touchscreen.
Okay.
And upgraded to the versions that were certified by the state of Illinois last year.
Okay. And we've been through pre-LAT on all those and tested them?
We've been through testing on all that, and we're going to do pre-LAT. Once we get the ballot laid out, we're going to do the pre-LAT prior to the election.
Okay, so they get tested again?
Yes, they do. Yes.
That is correct.
Yes.
So they've all been through with maintenance, so all of the parts and functionality of the equipment is tested at the same time that we implemented the upgrade. So we did the upgrade, and then we did the preventative maintenance, and then we'll move into pre-LAT and recovery.
Okay.
That's all they had. Anybody else?
Yeah, I have a question. Yeah. Paige, have the issues with the State Board of Elections and defend the vote been resolved, and is that issue now cleared up?
Yes, sir. I mean, my understanding is that it was resolved at the October board meeting, and I believe Ms. Maroney is continuing her accusations, but it is resolved. The State Board has come on and said that you guys are operating a certain way.
Everything we're using is approved.
Yes.
Well, Lance, a question on the, or did you have a comment on
Yeah, that? I just wanted to let you know that I've been asked by people at City Council about the same issue, and I told them, and I also showed the letter that we received from the State Board, and they're satisfied with it.
Okay. The need for additional space for the Electoral Board hearings, is it possible that, well, it's preferable, certainly, to have that space here, but are you also discussing the possibility of other nearby space that would be available and dedicated just for those hearing purposes?
You know, we did that many years ago, and it was a disaster. I want to try to keep everything in this building. At one time, we also used the State of Illinois building, their arena or conference room, and it turned out to be running people back and forth. So I'm really trying to get everything inside this building.
Obviously, that would be the first choice.
Yes. But if not, then I'll sit down with Mr. Scanlon and we'll figure out what we can do. But I don't want to give up hope of getting everything inside this building.
That's all.
Okay. Anything, Marisol?
No.
Okay.
Fine.
Okay.
Mr. Chairman, if possible, as I'd like to keep this infrastructure on the agenda from now on, because I would like to update the board members while projects are being finished.
Yeah, definitely.
Yeah, it has been on the agenda.
It is, but, right, but I just want to keep it on the agenda, and every meeting I'd like
reports
to give an update.
Each meeting.
Yes.
Excellent. And we'll put the poll books on there, too.
Mm-hmm.
Got it.
I think we've covered voting equipment, I think, right?
Yes, we have.
Okay.
I think I need to make a correction. I said that the versions that we recently upgraded were certified last year, but we're in a new year, so it was 2012,
right.
Correct.
Yes. Legislation, Mr. Scanlon?
Nothing to report, Mr. Chairman.
Okay. New business under apparent conformity. Mr. Scanlon?
Mr. Chairman and Commissioners, as you know, every election cycle, the board does receive at least petitions seeking to place questions of public policy on the ballot, if not candidates. And of course, a candidate only occurs in the municipal general election every 4 years. But we do get petitions for questions of public policy, and it's been the practice of the board to review those petitions to see whether or not they are in apparent conformity with the requirements of the election code. The board long ago, 1998, adopted rules with regard to the examination of petitions and determination for apparent conformity. Those rules require that the board shall, within 10 business days after the last day for filing such petitions, that they be examined by the board to determine whether they are in apparent conformity with the requirements of the election code. This year, for the March 18, 2014 election, the deadline for filing petitions seeking to place public questions on the ballot was Monday, December 16th. The 10th business day after that deadline was December 31st of 2013. We're now beyond that 10 business day deadline. For that reason, I believe the board should follow and adhere to its rules. And since we are beyond the deadline for acting on parent conformity, that the board take no action with regard to any question of apparent conformity for the March 18th, 2014 general primary election.
Are there any petitions? Is there a deadline for filing these petitions?
The deadline was December 16th. Oh. Right. And 10 business days thereafter mm-hmm. was December 31st.
And do we have any?
There were three general questions. One was a question whether the Cook County Board exercises authority to require the Chief Judge of the Cook County Circuit Court immediately issue an administrative order to all electronic recording and domestic relations courtrooms where no court reporter is present and litigants cannot afford a private court reporter at a cost of $250 to $350 per hour, not including transcripts. That was question number one. When the staff looked at this, seemed to meet all the requirements of the code. There was a second question. Should Ames Middle School, 1920 North Hamlin Avenue, be maintained as a neighborhood school rather than being converted into a military high school? There was one petition that was filed which sought to submit this to voters in four precincts in Ward 26, three precincts in Ward 35, and one precinct in Ward 1. Staff took a look at this, and that seemed to be an apparent conformity. There was a third question. Shall the City of Chicago require a minimum wage of $15 per hour for employees of companies that perform work within the City of Chicago where the employing company had annual gross revenues in excess of $50 million in the last tax year? With regard to this question, there were petitions filed in 103 precincts. Out of the 103, the staff looked at them, and there was only one where there was a question of apparent conformity that didn't contain enough signatures. So there was one out of 103. But again, because we're beyond a 10-day business day deadline for taking action, according to the board's rules, my recommendation would be the board not taking action with regard to apparent conformity on any of these petitions.
Well, I make a motion that we not, the board not take any action with regards to the issue of apparent conformity. And we allow these petitions to be placed on the ballot.
Second.
Moved and properly seconded. Further discussion? Hearing none, all those in favor?
Aye. Aye.
That'll be the order.
Thank you.
Jim, in order to avoid this issue in future election cycles, can we have, I'm asking this as a question, can we in effect open the matter of apparent conformity when we convene and then continue from time to time so that at least there's the case, so to speak, pending and we don't run into this 10-day limit? We would want to try and comply with it, but with electoral board hearings, if you open the case, you don't have to complete it within 3 days or 5 days.
Well, I believe the board can take the matter up. If there's some unfinished business, then they can continue a board meeting. That certainly could be the case. Another possibility, again, is just to look at the board rules to see if there should be any further amendments with regard to the timing of taking up these issues, and perhaps they could be addressed that way. I'll take some responsibility for this, and I will try to make sure that going forward, it can be put on the agenda for a board meeting so that whatever deadlines are in the board rules presently or as amended in the future, that the board will be in a position to take appropriate action in a timely manner.
Well, I think we should have hit at the worst possible time, right over the Christmas and up to New Year's dates.
Well, the timing certainly wasn't very good, no.
Okay, thank you. Anything else in your legal status report?
No, Mr. Chairman.
Quite a busy few weeks for you?
More than usual.
All righty. Financial report, we do not have one. Public comment section, does anybody want to address this today? There's no need for an executive session, Mr. Gough, Mrs. Scanlon?
No, Mr. Chairman.
Then I'll accept a motion to recess till our next regularly scheduled meeting, which would be, do you want to meet on the 14th? Probably do, right? Well.
Is it possible to do a short, very short special board meeting on Thursday, the 29th, and shortly after the electoral board meeting?
That'll be fine.
Okay.
And then will we need the 14th, or?
I don't think we need the 14th.
You said the 9th or the 29th?
The 9th.
29th.
9th.
No.
9th.
9th.
You said the 29th, but you meant the 9th.
We knew what you meant.
We knew. Okay.
Well, then we'll determine at that time whether we need the 14th.
Right.
All right. Is there a motion to recess to the 9th?
Motion to recess.
Moving properly second. Further discussion? Hearing none, all is in favor?
Aye.
That'll be the order. Thank you.